In this video, we're going to discuss Ruby on Rails version 7. So Ruby on Rails 7 came out last month, around the middle of December, so the end of 2021. And in this video, we're going to have a quick look at some of the new features that have been shipped as part of Rails 7 and what that means for us going forward with Ruby on Rails. So it's been quite some time since I covered any Ruby on Rails videos, but it's good to get back into this and have a look at some of the new features that are coming out and what it will mean for us going forward. And if you enjoyed this video, make sure to give it a like and subscribe to the channel. And I'm also taking recommendations. I really want to try and build some things in Ruby on Rails 7 to test it out. So let me know in the comments if you have any ideas of small applications I can build to test this out and let you guys see it. And if you're interested in using Ruby on Rails for your own startup or your own business, you can use some of the templates that I have for sale on my website. So you can visit the link in the description below to check that out. And I have a demo application for each of these, and you can add them to the cart just to purchase directly. So they have finally updated the RubyOnRails.org website. And I think that this is really overdue. So they've updated the website and it talks a little bit about the new version of Ruby on Rails. We can see here from the top of the website that it mentions that the goal is to compress the complexity of modern web applications. So I like the stance they're taking on this, because modern web applications can get very complicated very quickly, especially in regards to the front-end technology that's used. A common concern that I hear quite a lot in regards to Ruby on Rails is that the scalability of it. So as you grow your application, will it scale with the number of users that you have? And it's good to see them address this. So they say here, Ruby on Rails scales from Hello World to IPO. So IPO in this case meaning when you are filing as a public company. So by that said, you would expect that you have hundreds of thousands of customers potentially, or users on your website. And if you have some time, I recommend checking out this video. So the video here that is posted gives you a walkthrough of setting up a new Rails 7 application. And it builds out a very simple blog that allows you to post comments. And the comments are then returned in real time. So they are streamed in real time using Hotwire.js. So Hotwire.js comes built into Ruby on Rails 7. Going down the page here, we can see a list of like really large companies that are using Ruby on Rails. And this just goes to show that, you know, the scalability factor really isn't an issue when you have such huge companies using Ruby on Rails. So it's good to note that there are a lot of big names that are still using Ruby on Rails. So just scrolling down the page now, I think it's really interesting that they've updated this website and how they've modernized it, because some of the videos I made before on my YouTube channel, you were able to see how outdated the Ruby on Rails website was. And I think it just really confirms that they are still working on this technology. They haven't, they're not retiring Ruby on Rails anytime soon. So they're actively working on it. They are shipping new versions and they're building in new features. So we can see here that Ruby on Rails is a full stack framework. They emphasize this part that it is full stack. So this means that you can build the front end of the application, the back end, and anything in between. You can use it to build APIs. You can use it to, you can use it to build practically anything that you may need, which is really, really helpful if you are trying to use a tool like this to build things quickly. So if you want to use an all-in-one tool to build things quickly, then Ruby on Rails is a good choice for that. And they give some examples here, such as rendering HTML templates, updating databases, sending, receiving emails, live pages via WebSockets, and queuing jobs for asynchronous work, storing uploads in the cloud, and et cetera, et cetera. So there's a lot of things that Ruby on Rails can be used to do. So directly underneath this, we have some code examples of controllers, models, views, and routes. So just to give you an idea of the file structure and where things go within the application. And directly underneath this, then we have a mention of Ruby on Rails being optimized for happiness. So Ruby is the underlying language behind Ruby on Rails. And if you're a follower of my channel, you'll probably know this by now, but Ruby is designed for developer happiness. I think that's how they used to describe it anyway. So The idea being that you can write code that is very clean, very lightweight, but you can achieve very large amounts of functionality without having to write very large amounts or verbose amounts of code. So it is developer friendly, and this is why I've been using it for so long, because it is very nice to write code in Ruby. So at the bottom of the page, they mention here about Hotwire. Now, Hotwire was introduced, I believe, in Ruby on Rails version 6, and I haven't done too much with it, but from my understanding, it is a replacement for something like Action Cable. So you can return data, stream data back to the browser in real time. A great example of that would be that if you have a blog post and someone writes a comment on that blog post, then it will also push that comment to all of the browsers that have that page open. So anyone who's on the website already on that page will automatically see that comment appearing in real time. So it's very nice to be able to get real-time data within your application, and they use Hotwire to do this. So this seems to be the future direction that Ruby on Rails is going in. So Hotwire seems to be the choice for doing streaming of data like that. We'll have a quick look here. I'm going to have a quick look here at the post about the new version of Ruby on Rails 7. So I'm not going to do any coding in this video. I'm just basically going over everything that has been released, some of the information that has been released. And then in some of the upcoming videos, I will do coding examples of using Ruby on Rails 7. I'm not going to go through this in too much detail, but I'll point out a couple of things that stood out for me. One of them is the separation or the removal of Node.js on the front end. So this is quite interesting, because the front end in Ruby on Rails 6 was very, very complex, in my opinion. And I've had numerous people reach out to me trying to figure out how to upgrade their applications from versions 5 to 6. And basically, the problems all seem to be around the JavaScript. So how that's compiled on the front end, or how it's bundled, and the dependency management that comes with that. So there are a lot of struggles I've had with Webpack on Rails 6. And I think anything to kind of change that direction is a good thing, in my opinion. So Hotwire is going to come as part of the default that will be built into Rails 7. So that uses Turbo and Stimulus, and it will make the front end experience much faster, much more pleasant to use. And from what I've seen, it's quite easy to set this up. You know, you just have to include a couple of lines of code, and you've got real-time streaming of data from your applications. It will push updates to all of the browsers that are on a specific page. So for example, I mentioned earlier about the comment on the blog post. So that's a very simple example of how that would work. You will see real-time updates of data in the application. There is also a mention here about decoupling of the JavaScript bundler, so you don't have to use Webpack anymore. So I think that's going to be quite interesting to see what people move to if they decide to do that. There are different CSS frameworks here being mentioned, so you can install some of these by default, from what I understand. So Tailwind, Bootstrap, and various other ones. So there's something down here I found quite interesting. There are a bunch of things here. I won't cover them all, but one of the things here is about encrypted attributes for Active Record. Now, previously they did that with passwords and I think maybe authentication tokens, but now they are doing that with everything, it seems like, all of the data in the database. So I'll need to explore that a little bit more to find out how that exactly works. Another cool thing I found here was the load async. So load async means that we can speed up the queries when loading a page. So if you had to run various different queries against the database, maybe you're loading users, you're loading their posts, you're loading something else. Previously, you would have had to do those one after each other. So that would get quite slow if you have a lot of queries being loaded against the database. But now you can do this asynchronously, so you can continue loading the page while these queries are being handled against the database. I think that's mostly what I'm going to cover in this video. We'll go into this a bit more detail once we start building an application, but I just want to cover this very briefly because it is very interesting that they have launched this new version of Ruby on Rails, and it just shows to me that the future of Ruby on Rails is very good right now. So there are a lot of things happening, new features being added, new versions being released. It just gives me a lot of confidence that using Ruby on Rails is a good choice still in 2022. Let me know your thoughts in the comments below. And if you enjoyed this video, make sure to give it a like and subscribe, and I will see you guys in the next one.